Hey, Scythe. Welcome back to the land of the living.
Thank you, sir.
You've never heard of the Millennium Falcon?
Should I have?
It's a ship that made the Kessel Run in less than 12 parsecs.
Hey, everyone, and welcome to Kessel Run Weekly. My name is Danny.
And I'm Kristen.
And this week we have a ton of exciting news.
Yeah, we sure do. What we got first, Danny?
So, you know this little known thing called The Mandalorian?
Oh my god!
So, the internet and collectively us were ablaze this past week when Jon Favreau decided to, you know, release his little nugget on Instagram. It's just, you know, no big deal. Let's just drop the synopsis for The Mandalorian.
Right.
So for those of you who may not have seen it, if you are in fact living under a rock, it says, after the stories of Jango and Boba Fett, another warrior emerges in the Star Wars universe. The Mandalorian is set after the fall of the Empire and before the emergence of the First Order. We follow the travails of a lone gunfighter in the outer reaches of the galaxy, far from the authority of the New Republic.
Ooh, so that's actually pretty exciting. I'm just not gonna lie, like, you've told me all this cool stuff about it so far, but when you just read that, I didn't put together that this is honestly still in between the same time that Resistance is right now too.
Yes.
So I wonder if they're gonna intersect in any way.
I don't know. So this one's supposed to be, I can't remember exactly how long, but Nerdist had actually gotten out of Favreau exactly how many months it was after, I think it's 3 years. It may be 3 years after Return of the Jedi. So, still not as close as Resistance is to Force Awakens, because I think Force Awakens, or Resistance is supposed to be 6 months before Force Awakens.
Okay.
So, they may not intersect.
Dang.
which would suck a little, but I'm really excited about this, like, Wild West kind of feel to this, the lone gunfighter.
Right. I'm pretty excited to see who this Mandalorian is.
Theories are that it's a gentleman from the Aftermath trilogy who actually found Boba Fett's gear near the Sarlacc pit. His name's Cobb Vanth. So, I don't know.
I kind of hope it's a woman.
That would be interesting.
We have seen a whole bunch of female Mandalorians. I mean, we have Sabine.
Mm-hmm. And Sabine's family.
And Sabine's family, her mom.
Bo-Katan.
Bo-Katan.
Katan. Sorry.
I know. We do this every
time. We will forever do that.
We will. It's our southernness.
And Han.
I know. When you said it, I realized it too. And I was like, Katan. Did you say it right? Did I say it right, though?
I don't know. I don't even know anymore. What's life?
Well, we gave you both options. One of them is right, so you just pick one. But, I mean, with the stories of Jango and Boba, I mean, those are really the only Mandalorians we've seen throughout the movies. Mm-hmm. So I think, I don't know, and this isn't me just being like a female. I'm like, women power! Yeah! Suck it, man! Like, I swear, it's not me doing that at all. Like, I just think it'd be really cool to see, like, a really cool, like, oh, there's a word I want to use, but this is a friendly show. Family-friendly show. A bad A female Mandalorian. I mean, if you're a female Mandalorian, you're already bad A, but you know, like, I think it'd be really cool. And they make it a point to never say anything to the gender.
They don't
do this. It doesn't say man or woman or he
just
or
says,
she.
Yeah, it just says that another warrior emerges.
Right. So they're keeping it very under wraps.
That would be interesting.
I think a female would be cool.
I think that would be cool, but I do think it's a man. I don't know. Only
okay,
because
man.
No. Hold on.
You just only want men because to rule the galaxy, don't
no,
you?
No. Only because, and this is probably like the worst comparison ever, but only because, like, if you look at Sabine's armor, Bo-Katan's armor, their mothers and everything, Mandalorian women armor is feminine.
And this one's not feminine.
This one's not feminine.
Fine, we'll get
another.
But
that doesn't say that it can't be. That's not what I'm saying. I'm not saying that it is impossible by any stretch of imagination.
Oh,
that
I
is
know.
Not the case.
But you're right. Thinking about that image that they put out,
maybe
it's not.
Maybe they break the mold. So I don't know. Yes, yeah, I don't think we even noted that, but yes, there is an image that I actually thought that was, like, fake. When I saw it, I thought it was, like, a screen capture of Battlefront, like a mod or something.
Yeah, it looks like somebody essentially ripped Boba Fett out of, like, the Tatooine scene.
Yeah.
And just stuck in another Mandalorian.
Yeah. And so, like, when I first saw it, it was before StarWars.com had published it. I think, I don't know who I saw it from, but it was on Instagram scrolling through, and I was like, this would be really cool. And then all of a sudden, StarWars.com was like, good thing you think it's cool, because it's real.
Right.
It almost, I lost my mind. I absolutely lost my mind. Also, so, you know, our love for the holiday special. Did you notice the gun on him?
No, I didn't.
It looks like the holiday special gun that Boba Fett has. The little prong gun.
Oh,
yeah. The butt of the gun. Let me see if I can pull it up real quick. While we're talking about it, I don't know if I'm going to be quick enough.
Maybe not. I guess I can go ahead and go to the next part.
Sure.
So, StarWars.com actually put a little something out about it. Oh, my.
See, doesn't it look like the holiday special gun?
I don't know. That could be a female, y'all.
You really want it to be. That's okay.
I just think it'd be cool. Like, we haven't seen really, other than, like, in Rebels, we haven't seen a really, like, strong, like, Mandalorian woman.
You're right.
So, I mean, we're not saying we're not going to get any in this series. Because, I mean, they very well, this could be a man. And very well, I mean, he could be working for a female. You know what I'm saying? Like, we don't know. So, It's cool, though.
Wouldn't it be cool if we got, like, a live action, either Sabine or Bo-Katan?
Bo would probably be cooler. I don't know if I'd like Sabine live action.
I don't know that she would be, only because I think by now she's still searching for Ezra. I guess it just really depends on if they find Ezra in 3 years' time.
Surely they have.
Because after the Battle of Endor, that's what her and Ahsoka go to do.
Right.
Spoilers. But Bo-Katan would be really cool to see, because she's the leader of Mandalore at this point.
Yeah, that's true.
So, yeah.
I don't know. Be cool. I'm just excited. It's new Star Wars.
Yeah.
So
StarWars.com had a little bit more to say about it. What say you, Kristen?
What say I? So the series will be written and executive produced by Emmy-nominated producer and actor Jon Favreau, which Jon Favreau has been actually doing a hefty amount in Star Wars here recently, which is really exciting.
Yeah,
so I'm glad.
Rio.
Yeah, I'm glad he's still heading it up and all. Absolutely. And as previously announced, Dave Filoni, who also did The Clone Wars and Star Wars Rebels, he's directing the first episode, which I think is super cool. Yes. So he's directing the first episode. And additionally, episodic directors included Deborah Chow from Jessica Jones. Ooh. She did Jessica Jones. Rick Famuyiwa, who produced or directed Dope.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know what that is.
Never seen it.
Bryce Dallas Howard, she directed Soulmates.
And was also in what favorite franchise of yours?
Jurassic World.
I was about to say, go ahead.
And daughter of Ron Howard.
Yes.
Very cool. And next we have Taika Waititi.
Yes.
Who
I was waited with bated breath to see if you were getting it right.
Interesting names. I'll look them up.
Taika Waititi.
Who did Thor Ragnarok.
Which I love.
Oh, Meek, you're alive. He's alive, guys. What was your question again, bro?
Yes. So we have a powerhouse here.
Absolutely.
Even though I don't really know who a couple of them are, I know Jessica Jones is really good. I don't know what Dope is. I'm very sorry, Rick. but Bryce Dallas Howard, like, even though I haven't really seen anything she's necessarily directed, I think it'll still be really cool. I mean, I like her a lot.
I think that it's cool that she's getting in on the same universe that her dad is, too.
Yeah, most definitely.
I think it's really neat.
Yes.
And so all of this, though, that means that Kathleen Kennedy's been fired, right?
Don't say that.
Joking, of course, because she's actually an executive producer on Mandalorian.
Yeah, and we know John, Dave, and also along with Kathleen Kennedy, it's going to be Colin Wilson as well.
Mm-hmm.
And then Karen Gilchrist will serve as co-executive producer.
Yeah.
So can I just say this real quick? I'm so sorry, Karen. But I think it's kind of funny. There's like 1, 2, 3, 4 like executive producers, and there's just like one co. It'd be like having 4 managers and like 1 co.
Look, it doesn't take a genius to know that any organization thrives when it has 2 leaders. Go ahead, name a country that doesn't have two presidents. A boat that sets sail without two captains. Where would Catholicism be without the popes?
You know what I mean? Like, why not just one
all the managers and a supervisor.
Exactly. Like, exactly. Like, I feel like it should have been the other way around. I feel like it should have been, like, one executive and the rest are, like, co-executives.
Yeah, you know who even knows how the film industry works?
Well, you know, I just think it's funny because, I mean, and I don't want to say this, like, in a negative way, but I just know the last time I think Star Wars tried to hire two directors in the same thing.
Oh, no.
I think they butted heads and one got fired.
Well, producers, I think, are a little bit different. Normally, there are multiple people producing, so...
So, hopefully, I'm sure it'll be fine.
It's fine.
I know it is. It's just funny. That's just what reminded me of, like, just the last time they had two people trying to head up, be the head honchos. They didn't do so hot.
You're
so
not wrong. Sorry, Lord Miller. But yeah, so The Mandalorian, though. Like,
yeah, I'm pretty stoked.
Absolutely. I'm super excited about it. So, all we know is that it will be coming to Disney streaming service. We do not know when. My only hope is that we at least get a trailer at Star Wars Celebration.
I'm sure. I mean, they have to, right?
I mean, there's going to be so much Star Wars to have at Star Wars Celebration. You'll have probably the first trailer for 9
right.
Come out. You've got The Mandalorian, without a doubt. I doubt that they'll do it earlier than that. Probably some more Clone Wars stuff.
Right. I wouldn't be surprised if we got, like, another Resistance trailer or something, depending on what they decided to do.
Season 2, something like that.
Yeah, exactly. Kind of like how they did with Rebels. When,
yeah,
it was
absolutely.
The last season of Rebels. Mm-hmm. They gave us a little, like, ta-ching.
Right. So something like that. You've also got the one from the Game of Thrones guys, the trilogy, the Rian Johnson's trilogy is still on the table. Sorry, Rian Johnson haters. Rian Johnson lovers, unite. So, I mean, there's still a lot coming down the pipeline, and I mean, I'm really excited. I'm super stoked. Excited doesn't even cut it.
I know. I'm ready for more on it. Like, I'm ready for more story, for, like, more looks at it, mm-hmm. just to know. I mean, we know kind of where it's set, but, like, we kind of don't, though. Like, we just have this big, huge timeline mm-hmm. from Revenge of the Sith.
Return of the Jedi.
Oh.
You always do that. One day.
So, we have this huge timeline from Return of the Jedi to The Force Awakens.
Yes.
Do not make fun of me, Mr. White. It's rude. Because, I mean, how long is that, Danny? Like, what?
30 years.
Oh, my God. So, so it's great that we're getting all this stuff that falls right in between it. But at the same time, we don't know.
It's a lot of gap.
It is.
So, I mean, yeah.
So this one takes place after 3 years.
3 years after Return of the Jedi. So shortly after the fall of the Empire, Battle of Jakku, all that kind of stuff.
I have to put some more stuff out then. Because, I mean, that means we have roughly, depending on how long this series goes on and how far it stretches, mm-hmm. we could still be looking at about 20 years until Resistance.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, if not more. Definitely. Give or take. That's saying that Mandalorian's going to be like a 10-year thing.
Mm-hmm.
I want more.
More story, please. Feed me.
We're so greedy. God, we're so greedy in first world countries. Like, look at us. You're giving us stuff and we want more.
Well, speaking of more, Kristen.
There's just a big gap, and I just want all the gaps to be filled, okay?
Oh, absolutely. Well, and I think they will, because that's the thing is, like, they spent a lot of time filling in the gaps between the prequel trilogy and original trilogy and everything with Rogue One, Rebels, and all that kind of stuff. A lot of the books.
I love Rogue One.
Yes. So they filled in a lot of gaps there, and so this is the most giant gap that they have right now.
Right.
And that's the thing is that before Resistance, the theory was that it was going to be closer to Return of the Jedi to fill in more of that, and we got it 6 months before. And so it's almost like, yeah, we're going to fill in some story. Not really. Thank you, though. but I'm excited about
you
it.
You know what I'd love to see?
What's that?
Because I feel like here in Star Wars, and a lot of people may not agree with me, but that's fine. I don't really care.
It's fine.
It's fine. I'll keep my opinion. It's fine. but one thing I'd really like to see is I've noticed here, you know, in Star Wars, we get all the sides of, like, the Resistance. Mm-hmm. And in comics and books, I'm sure they give us, you know, First Order. First Order perspective. And not just First Order, but the Republic, too.
Mm-hmm.
Give us, you know, that perspective from there. Mm-hmm. But I think I really wish they would do like something after Mandalorian. Mm-hmm. And or it could be even during. I don't even care where it falls, as long as it falls in that 30-year gap and kind of gives us that rise of that First Order. So I think, I mean, obviously kidnapping kids wouldn't be the best thing to see on TV or on a show, whatever. It is. Yeah. I mean, maybe not make it necessarily like a, maybe like an after the fact thing. Like, mm-hmm. Oh, we got all these kids. We didn't see you kidnap them, obviously, but we know what happened. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, just kind of like a, it's like foreshadowing, I guess, or foretold that it's mm-hmm. what happened.
Well, and so to your point, though, with the Mandalorian and it being on the outskirts of, away from the New Republic and everything, it's possible that a lot of this shady stuff that the First Order was doing comes from there.
Maybe, but I mean, it obviously won't be set around that. And that's what I'd like to see, though, is mm-hmm. that rise of the First Order.
Okay.
Essentially, I'd like to see who was like,
who did it, how it happened, all that kind of stuff.
Yeah, or I mean, I don't know. It doesn't have to be like a word-for-word origin story necessarily, but mm-hmm. just something along that time frame and that storyline.
Yeah.
I think it'd be cool. We've never gotten anything on, like, the bad side.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Like, it's always been, like, rebels for the resistance.
Yeah.
All the Star Wars movies are for the resistance, for the rebels. So,
yeah.
All of it.
Like, well, and I mean, and in side note on that, I liked how in Resistance, Yeager, one of the characters that is used to be a rebel, mentioned something about, no, it wasn't Yeager, it was Kaz's dad, said that something about the resistance, and he calls them extremists.
Mm. He does, but that's not the first time we've heard that.
Mm-mm.
It was Saw. Mm-hmm. Saw Gerrera in Rogue One.
Made a name for him as well.
Yeah, mm-hmm. He was known as extremist, though.
Yep.
So I wonder if that's where that kind of came from, is because Saw Gerrera was in making a bad name for the rebels, though, mm-hmm. because of what he was doing, because his way of doing things was so,
like, War Gullet.
Yes.
Can you use War Gullet as an adjective?
I mean, sure, I'll take it. It's fine with me. But his were just so crazy and,
right,
just for lack of better words, extreme. And so that's why he kind of became an extremist. So mm-hmm. I feel like that's where that word and where that, like, way of looking at that has come from. I mean,
in all intents and purposes, from a certain point of view, the rebels and resistance can be kind of characteristic as terrorists, because they're fighting against a larger system and everything. And so to some people, they're extremists, they're terrorists, they cause havoc.
Right.
Where otherwise, in some places, there's peace. But that's not the case in all places. So
nope. And some of the places I've seen in, like, Clone Wars, they don't get peace for long.
Nope.
Mandalore.
Yep, not at all.
You tried to be neutral, and it didn't work.
The war still found you.
It did.
Yep,
it
absolutely. Did. So speaking of more Star Wars, though, we have a lot more announced coming out of New York Comic Con.
We do. A lot of publishing.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So the first big thing that was announced there, because there was a lot of stuff there, so we're just kind of cherry picking what we've decided would be cool. And, you know, we can tell you about a cover that was released, but then you could just see it on our social media and things right. like that. So at Kessel Run Weekly, Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter.
Shameless plug.
But for this one, so we have a new book that's coming out June 2019 called Alphabet Squadron. So this is set after Return of the Jedi, as everything seems to be now. Alphabet Squadron follows a unique team of pilots, each flying a different class of starfighter as they struggle to end the war they fought so long for once and for all. So, the alphabet thing coming from that each one of them has an X-Wing, a Y-Wing, a U-Wing, a B-Wing, an A-Wing, stuff like that. So, they're the Alphabet Squadron. Cute name, right? I'm not crazy about the name, but I'm interested. What do you think?
I don't really have many thoughts on this, honestly. I'm just literally just trying to let it wrap around my head at the moment. I'm just wondering who it's going to be. Like, if it's going to be any familiar faces or names.
What if Shriv is in there?
That's what I'm
from,
wondering.
From Battlefront 2. That would be cool.
That'd be kind
of
cool.
Because I think, didn't he fly an A-Wing? Or am I thinking of someone else?
Oh, I don't know, honestly.
I'm not sure.
I'm so sorry, I don't know.
Yeah, I could be wrong. I could be very wrong.
I flew through that game. Through it. I just wanted to see the ending.
We need to revisit that.
We do. We really do.
We definitely need to revisit that story.
We do, because I think we missed a lot of stuff. That's because mm-hmm. it was just so new, and y'all, like, I just fly through games. Anytime there's a game in front of me, I'm just like, fuck!
It's that consumption monster. It's like, oh, new game! I need it! Oh, it's over.
Yeah.
Go home.
Exactly. And then I betrayed Danny by playing the last part before The Last Jedi came out. It didn't give anything away, though.
It didn't. I was very terrified that it was, though.
I mean, there was an important part in it. Mm-hmm. But it didn't really give anything away from The Last Jedi.
True.
Which kind of was weird, because I thought that was supposed to tie in directly, but it's fine.
It kind of closed the gap up, too.
I mean, I guess it did.
But not really. Kind of, sort of. But anyways, that's another podcast.
Anyway, yeah, so we'll have to we'll have to go back to Battlefront 2 and do some stuff there.
But yeah, so I mean, Alphabet Squadron, not wild about the name. I am interested to see how a squadron of different classes of starfighters works. If it's like kind of like how you would have different classes of a team together or something like that, like when you're running a raid or whatever in a video game or something like that. I wonder if it kind of works that way. Maybe it's like specialty missions? I don't know. Like, it doesn't give us much on this.
I don't know. You think we could see any of our resistance friends? This is probably set too early, though, isn't it?
Maybe Yeager. Maybe. He's an ex-rebel.
Or
Griff Halloran, who is a ex-TIE pilot.
Yeah. But say, if not that, maybe we'll see some, like, maybe some parents or something.
Possible, yeah.
Because, I mean, obviously a lot of these, I think, that are in Resistance right now are kids.
Right.
But, I mean...
This would be before the formation of the New Republic. So it'd be as they're forming the New Republic. So that's quite very possible. Yeah.
But, I mean, I feel like they had to want to fly from somewhere.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of them, probably their parents flew or something. And that's why they want to be a pilot like their dad or their mom.
Yeah, definitely. I just want to be like dad.
But
so yeah. So that one's kind of a wait and see for me.
Yeah, same here. Yeah. So also we're getting a Han Solo comic called Imperial Cadet. Pretty excited about this. So absolutely. Robbie Thompson on the core of Han Solo, Imperial Cadet, he says it's about the morality of violence. The comic was pitched as Star Wars meets Full Metal Jacket meets Stripes. I don't know what any of those are.
I know Full Metal Jacket's a war movie. I mean, and I think Stripes is like a comedy. I'm not sure. I haven't seen either one of them either.
Am I even guess?
We don't watch anything other than Star Wars.
I kind of understand what Full Metal Jacket is, but I've never seen it.
Full Metal Jacket, that's definitely a war movie.
Yeah, so, definitely. Yeah. Stripes, sorry. I would guess war, because I don't know. Whatever. Anyway.
Yeah.
Thompson referred to the series as being year one and said it was a great opportunity to tell some stories, but also noted that it's far from all of Han's cadet adventures. I think it's pretty cool because, I mean, we didn't get much in Solo about that little cadet.
About him being an Imperial cadet. Yeah.
Right. Other than him being on the desert. And then there's a deleted scene of him essentially...
Getting court-martialed,
pulling some stunt, getting court-martialed, and then getting kicked off into the desert, essentially.
Oh, we'll have you flying in no time. They really like that joke. They do it twice. Once in the deleted scene, and they're like, you know what? No, we'll do it this other way.
It was like that non-negotiable line.
Right.
So they just had to find another place to put it.
We don't like the scene, but this is staying.
Right. I worked really hard on that line. So, I mean, I'm pretty excited about it. I mean, I don't want to think about Han Solo being in the Imperial Army, I guess, but it did happen, and I don't know, I guess I just kind of want to see that story, but, because, I mean, I don't know.
I would be excited to see it, because maybe we'll get to see more of his time as an Imperial pilot, and everything, and more of the Imperial Navy than the ground troops, because we get... Oh, yeah, we'll have you flying in no time, and they throw him into the mud of Nimbin. So I'm more excited to see his antics in between, because obviously time had passed between then to then and everything. And so, I don't know. I'm interested in more of that story.
That was like it was a 10-year gap, wasn't it? Because doesn't Kira say it's been like 10 years? Or maybe she says it's a long time ago.
I think it was like, I think it had been a year.
No, it hasn't. No, there's no way.
It wasn't 10 years.
There's no way it was just a couple years.
May have been 3. I don't know. It hadn't been that long.
Okay. We'll roll with it. Whatever. I thought it's been a lot longer than that.
No, I don't think it was 10 years. Because he would have grown up much more in 10 years.
You say that, but...
I don't know. I don't think he had been in the Navy that long. I think that... Because, I mean, his whole goal was to get back to her.
Yeah, but...
So, I don't know. I wouldn't say more than just a couple, 3 years, something like that.
But I just feel like that wouldn't be a long time ago to me, though. Like, it had to be at least 3+ years for me to say that was a long time ago. Mm-hmm. Like, it wouldn't just be last year. And I'm like, oh, man.
So we'll agree on 3.
Whatever.
But I'm really excited about this comic series. I think it'll be really cool. I'm all up for more Han Solo. I love Han Solo. I loved the Solo movie. It didn't get near the recognition that it should have gotten. So, yeah. Did you find out the answer?
No.
Oh, okay.
I'll find it later.
But, yeah. So, again, I don't think it got the recognition that it deserved at all. But I'm really excited to see where it goes from there. So, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So, cool.
Very exciting.
So, our last bit of news, which... Is probably you know, we can always add that in post. You don't have to sing it every time. You just like singing it.
I do.
Okay.
I like singing it just as much as I like hearing it. So.
You know, you don't have to do that every time.
I'm sure my fans enjoy it, Danny.
People say they love me.
I still want those little, like...
The kazoos?
Yes.
Oh my God. I'm not getting you a kazoo for that fact. I'm just kidding. I'll get you a kazoo.
I want a kazoo. The fans will love it.
So, on to our last bit of news, once again. So, it was announced Shadow of Vader was going to be a new series from Chuck Wendig. So this is actually what Chuck Wendig had to say. This was on StarWars.com with everything, all the announcements from New York Comic Con's publishing and things like that. He had to say, Vader is a character with a long shadow, literally and figuratively. His legacy is deep and unpleasant. The world will not be bereft of Darth Vader in their comics for long, as Wendig announced that he will be writing a miniseries called Shadow of Vader, beginning in November. It's so close! Each issue will feature a different set of characters. Issue 1 is a Friday the 13th homage, ooh, with Vader hunting down kids at a summer camp. I need that. Thanks for that.
I love you.
Issue 2 stars the one and only Wilrow Hood. So very exciting there. If you don't know who Wilrow Hood is, watch Empire Strikes Back. He is the only man running through the hallways with a ice cream maker. Not a space ice cream maker. An ice cream maker.
Legit.
Issue number 3 centers on a morgue attendant on the Death Star. So I wonder how many people a day he gets that are choked out by Vader. Issue number 4 diverges to focus on the acolytes of the beyond. Ooh. Issue number 5 follows a New Republic pilot, which I think this is the most interesting.
Yes.
Whose parents were killed by Vader, who joins the resistance only to learn that Leia's father is the Sith Lord. That sounds like super drama.
Mm-hmm.
So what do you think?
Trust her. She'll turn to the dark side just like her father.
Yeah. So what do you think about that announcement?
I think it's pretty darn cool, honestly. I like how it's going to be like different episodes, different issues, essentially. And I mean, they're obviously probably going to
connect in some way.
Maybe not, though.
I don't know.
I mean, they're going for like a Friday the 13th kind of idea. Yeah. So. Well,
I wonder if it's more of like the book that came out that was The Legends of Luke Skywalker, kind of like the Vader stuff or whatever. So it's like a mini series about a mini series kind of thing, like episode of the week kind of thing.
I don't know. I'm pretty interested, though. And you know, the funny part is I don't even really care for comics that much. Yeah. But I might just have to read this one. You're just gonna have to remind me when it comes out.
Of course. It'll be next month, November.
Oh, cool.
All right. So that is our news for the week. So also, quick shameless plug, if you haven't checked out Resistance, it just came on this Sunday. Absolutely check it out. It was a lot of fun. We did a review on The Recruit, which was the first episode. We had a blast with it, so if you have not already checked that out, please check that out.
Yes.
But on to something that we are very excited about. we got some reviews from iTunes, Kristen.
We did. Oh my gosh. We love you guys. sorry they're a little late. We honestly didn't get the notifications like we thought we would, so we kind of had to just go through and
find them. I have an Android phone. She has the Apple, and neither one of us really knew what we were looking for, so I'm very sorry. So here are all the reviews.
So our first review comes from A.E. Welling, and they say, I'm new to the show. Dean and Kristen talk all things Star Wars in a really fun way. I'm a longtime Star Wars podcast listener of many Star Wars shows. Theirs is now among my many.
Thank you. Welcome to the show.
Yes, welcome. We're so glad to have you.
Yes, we're so glad you decided to join us.
Yes.
We are honored that you joined us.
We are so honored. For the second one, we have Lady Deadpool 069.
Which is our friend Kira Knight, Mando Woman.
And she says, love this show. Been listening since the 10th episode. I love the lighthearted expression of love for Star Wars brought to us by Danny and Kristen.
Oh.
Not only is the podcast fun and interesting, but the hosts actually interact with their fans and care about what we have to say. Definitely my favorite Star Wars podcast to date. Keep it up, guys. May the Force be with you always.
Aww.
That is so...
You're choking up.
No, I'm not. I'm fine. I got choked up when I read it for the first time.
Yeah.
But it's fine.
That's really sweet. Thank you so much. That yes. really means a lot to us. And just like she said, guys, we love talking with you guys. Like 98% of the fun of doing this podcast is getting to talk with all of you Star Wars fans out there.
Most definitely.
They're just like us. You guys are hilarious. You're awesome. You're fun. We honestly can't wait to meet you at Star Wars Celebration.
Right.
So, yeah.
Yeah, we really couldn't do this without you guys.
Absolutely. So. We really appreciate it.
Yeah. Most definitely. So, are we ready to move on to our main topic?
Our main topic!
I got a bad feeling about this.
I'm not afraid.
You will be. You will be.
Yay! So, if you've been tuning in, you'll know this is technically our only our second episode into our Monster Madness!
Monster Madness.
Yay! But, guys, so we are talking about Brain Invaders, which is a Clone Wars episode.
Mm-hmm. From season two, I believe.
Episode
yeah.
8.
Mm-hmm.
I guessed that earlier, just by the way. That was really cool. Danny was, like, scrolling through all
you
the episodes.
Money on that.
I really should have. But Danny, like, started, like, season 4 or 5 or something like that.
Yeah.
He was just scrolling through, like, I don't know where it's at. And I was like, I bet it's in season 2. Sure enough, that little punk went to season 2, and guess where it was, fools.
But the thing is like, you weren't even, like, invested. You were just like, bet it's in season 2. Like you were just trying to be like, yeah, whatever.
It's just the luck of the Irish. Side note, I have red hair and freckles. So, in case that was, like, weird to anyone
She's
else.
The most Irish in the room, so there you go.
This is true. So, with our Brain Invaders episode, got anything to say on it so far, Danny? No, I'm just kidding. So the first thing that kind of stood out to me though in this episode was the beginning. Because
the fortune cookie. Yes.
The fortune cookie, thank you. I was like, there's a word for this.
Yes.
I just some reason didn't think it was a fortune cookie. Mm-hmm. Speaking of, I just ate one of those a little bit ago. No, I see another one sitting over there I want to eat. but the fortune cookie on the opening of this episode is attachment is not compassion.
What did you interpret that as? Because I'm still trying to figure it out. I
Are
think.
You?
Yeah.
Okay. See, I have to talk about the whole episode, though.
Let's do that. Let's do that, then. And okay. then we'll come back to it.
Okay, we'll yeah. back around.
So it starts off with attachment is not compassion.
It does, yes. So it looks like we start out in Geonosis. Looks
Genosis.
Like we start out on Geonosis, mm-hmm. which... I don't know much about. Do you have any background there?
So Geonosis first appears in Attack of the Clones. It's the staging ground and the birthplace of the Clone Wars, where everything starts.
Oh, yeah.
Yes. Where Anakin, Padme, and Obi-Wan were captured, and all the Jedi come to save
harassed
them.
Harassed by giant monsters.
Yes, harassed by giant monsters. greatly. So, hey, monsters, there you go.
Woo!
Monsters. So it kind of is the beginning of everything, and in the course of the Clone Wars, essentially the clone army has subdued the planet and got it under Republic control, to where there's not going to be an uprising, all this other kind of stuff. So in the previous episode, the Jedi are called there because they've lost the planet, all that kind of stuff, and they can't understand how they were able to basically subdue the clone army and get the planet back. And they go to investigate, and they find a hive of undead Geonosians and Hive Queen and all this other kind of stuff. And they're like, all this crazy stuff, very zombie-like and everything. So that's where our episode ends, is they've won all that good stuff. So, which brings us to our current episode, where it comes up on a group of clone troopers that are sleeping and hanging out and everything, and then their commanding officer comes, wakes them up, and in that time, poor unfortunate Scythe has been invaded in the brain.
Poor unfortunate Scythe.
He has a little like green nasty worm hatch out of a ball like egg.
Yeah,
and crawl up his nose.
So gross!
It's disgusting. It gives me the creeps thinking about it.
It does, and it's so funny, guys. If you've been paying attention to our episodes and all, you know that we like to watch all of the shows and movies with subtitles.
Yes.
So one of the subtitles from these little worms.
I forgot about this.
These little worms were slithering around.
Yeah.
The subtitle said moist slithering.
Yeah.
It did it like two or three times, and both times me and Danny were just like we just had the shivers.
It added to the creep factor. It absolutely added to the creep factor.
It most definitely did.
So every time.
Yeah, every time. It was gross. So poor Scythe. And as he's taken over by this brain invader worm, he actually takes a lot of the eggs with him that these brain invaders hatch out of, and he takes them onto the plane or to the
onto the ship. Yeah, and the way he gets up off the ground too.
Oh my gosh, yes, he like
it's like does exorcist style.
It is. I'm gonna say it's like this back crackling like.
Yeah.
Like,
in my nightmares.
You know? I like one of the lines one of the other troopers said. They're like, "Welcome back to the living."
Yeah. Oh yeah, as they're going onto the ship.
Yeah.
Like, "Welcome back to the land of the living."
Yeah, and it's like
ha ha.
Little did you know, little buddy.
Yep. You're all about to be zombies.
Pretty much. That's essentially that's the weird part about this episode to me, is it seems like they're like that.
Mm-hmm.
But I got a little confused towards the
So let's talk about that. So essentially, at first, you think the symptoms of brain invasion from the worm, the parasite, are that they don't speak. Their eyes roll in the back of their head, and they just have like this really mean expression.
Yes,
it's like they're
angry.
Just completely silent because they don't speak at all. Later in the episode, the further that we go, all of a sudden, it's like the worms become intelligent.
Does it's very odd.
And they even make the clones speak Geonosian at one point when they're all like meeting and holding one of them down to put the worm in his nose, and just saying it gives me the creeps.
Right. So at this point though, Scythe has already taken all the eggs into the ship, and as all the troopers are sleeping, he like literally rolls the eggs down the aisle
like a freaking grenade.
Yeah, pretty much. And then they hatch, and obviously it takes over the rest of the troopers that are there. The weird part to me, though, is, like, so the troopers start going in, and they start trying to take over the ship. So a couple of them, actually three of them, to be precise, three go into the
cabin of the ship. Yeah.
And take out the pilots. And then a couple of them go and try to take care of Barriss and Ahsoka. Well,
how'd it feel seeing Barriss again? Because the last time we talked about her, it was when she was a traitor.
Traitor! That's literally what I said.
Traitor!
Since I saw her, but I was like, traitor! But, I don't know. She wasn't wrong, though. That's the thing. The thing that made me the most mad about her is the fact that she tried to frame Ahsoka. Like, you monster.
Well, so what I was thinking during this episode while we were watching it is, so this is Barriss before betrayal.
Mm-hmm.
Ahsoka and Barriss have a conversation where Ahsoka's talking about how she doesn't know if we have what it takes and all that kind of stuff and everything. And Barriss says, well, what does your master think? And Ahsoka's like, ha, I don't know if you want to know that.
Right.
Like, he has some kind of extreme views and everything.
Whatever it takes.
He'll do whatever it takes. And she's just kind of like, oh, okay. And it's almost like plants the seeds.
Yeah.
It seems like. Because the way Barriss receives it, because at this point, she's just an obedient student.
Mm-hmm.
She seems like kind of like the brainy student that is heeding on every single word the teacher's saying and everything. Because she's like, well, what does your master tell you? What does this say? Da, da, da. And right. everything. Really not giving any information of her own or advice of her own.
Right.
She's regurgitating really, information.
Yeah, she's really prodding in a concerning way. Right. Like, she's more just concerned and doesn't want to give any, like, feedback, mm-hmm. really. Just kind of getting all these, like, oh, okay, gotcha.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Like, this is what I read in a book one time kind of thing. Yeah.
Yeah. Funny, though.
My master says.
Right. But funny, though, is as that scene's going on, that's when the couple of troopers walk in and try to take them out.
Mm-hmm.
And then next thing we know, they're like all handy-dandy with their lightsabers. Joom, joom, joom.
Yep.
Take them out. Don't kill them, though. Just takes them out. Just knocks them out unconscious. Couple more walk in. And they're like, oh, it's funny, too, because Ahsoka and Barriss both had their lightsabers up towards their throats. And they're like, what are you doing? Tell us what's happening. Start questioning them, which I don't blame them. Mm-hmm. The thing that got me, which I thought was kind of crazy, was these troopers were completely unconscious.
Mm-hmm.
They were talking. They're like, oh, my God, we just heard shooting. And we just ran in here to see what was happening. Like, da 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 da. And just kind of, like, seemed really concerned. So unless there was a scene there that I missed, like, somehow...
They were infected at that point.
Right.
They had the parasite at that point.
Right.
The parasite just realized, my first tactic didn't work.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
So because they even put their guns down, they're like seeming all innocent, like, no, we're just here to help. Like, da da da. So they all walk out in the hallway and they try to get to, I think, the cabin. I think it's where they go in, like, it's like covered by like electrical. Field or red or something electric.
Oh yeah, so you talking about when Barriss leaves?
No.
Oh okay.
No. When they go into the cabin to go get into the front of the ship to see what's happening because they realize that.
Oh yeah.
Okay. Something's going on. Mm-hmm. So it's like covered with like electric doors or something.
It's ray shielding.
Ray shielding. Yes. So it's got a bunch of ray shields in front of it. As they try to approach the cabin, realize that somebody's in there that doesn't want them in there.
Mm-hmm.
So, as Barriss is, like, kneeling down to, like, I'm going to try to disable this, the clone behind her, like, points its gun at her. And this point, it's that same clone that was in that room with them that was like, I'll put down my gun. Like, it's fine. Because I was like, they're totally not infected. This is cool. No, they were infected.
Yep.
They were infected indeed.
What's worse than zombies? Conscious zombies.
Right. That's essentially
zombies
what it
was.
Zombies
that actually have brains and are not trying to eat brains.
Right. That's exactly what it was, too. And so it pulled its gun on her, and at that point, they realized, oh, no, like, everyone must be infected. Let's go somewhere. I think they run off and hide or something for a little bit and kind of try to get their plans together and what they're going to do.
Yeah. And they decide, just like in every horror movie, to split up.
Which Ahsoka is against.
Yes, she does is say, absolutely against.
Yeah, she does say that she doesn't think that's the best idea. But, I mean, Barriss makes a good point, too, in saying, like, they don't have that luxury.
Mm-hmm.
Because there's obviously too much going on. She's like,
I mean, if you think about
one of us.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
No, you're fine. I was just saying, as she essentially says, they don't have that luxury. She's like, one of us has to, she didn't say survive. What she said? There's a word there.
Basically, yeah. To survive. To succeed. Succeed.
Thank you. I was like, I know. One of us has to succeed. So she already thinks that, like... To me, it already seems like she knows she's weaker than Ahsoka.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Because at that point, she... I don't know. She just... The way she kind of words it and the way she kind of looks and says it, she just seems like... Oh, she's... One of the things she says to Ahsoka, she's like, I know you'll do what you have to do.
Mm-hmm.
God, I know you do what it takes. Yeah. So she almost sees herself as being the weaker one. As in she won't do what it takes to ensure that, like, this doesn't reach the medical bay, essentially, or the medical station.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, But what were you saying?
What I was saying, what was I saying? I don't remember now.
I was talking about the succeed at the when they're in the air vent.
Oh, so thinking about their plan and everything, so I think Barriss was right. Because if you think about how that plays out, so after they split up, the next scene immediately is Barriss sneaking around a hallway and everything, and she starts sneaking into this corridor, and all of a sudden, she stumbles across a stun trap and is, like, electrified and everything, and the clones come up behind her and is like, if it's one thing we clones know how to do is to catch a Jedi. By the way, Order 66, flash forward.
Right, well, that's just kind of crazy to me anyway, because, yeah. I mean, which we realize at this point that they are conscious. Like, these aren't just, like, dead zombies.
Yeah, which is worse.
Right, but it's...
much worse.
But it's creepy to me how they're able to, like, access the brain of whoever of the clone, they're...
Yeah.
Yeah, because they obviously have all that knowledge and intelligence of, like, how the clones do things and what they do in order to fit in. In order to make themselves seem like they, which I mean, that's essentially what a brain invader is, I guess. When you think about it, it's got to get in there and it's got to fit in. Yeah.
We've been joking the last couple weeks about invasion of the body snatchers. This is exactly that.
Yeah.
they snatched the body. That's
like, it's creepy how unnoticed it can go.
Mm-hmm. Like, and I even made the comment at one point, the way that they looked, it was literally like lights were on, but no one's home. Or that person is not home, rather. Somebody's home.
Right.
But yeah, but they catch Barriss and force a worm up her nose.
Pretty much.
Worms and noses. No. I'm not gonna be able to sleep tonight. I'm gonna be like wiping my nose all night long, like but they put a worm up her nose, and so now not only do they have all the clones on the ship, just about, they have a Jedi.
Right. So as it goes, Ahsoka actually is able to succeed. She can reach, because what she's actually going to do is she's going to find a way to communicate with
Kit Fisto.
Kit Fisto. I knew I almost said it wrong. I almost said Kit Fisto. I don't know what I almost said. Fisto Kitta. I don't know. Either way, though. So she's going to communicate with Fit Kisto.
Kit Fisto. I can't believe you actually did it. Fit Kisto. There you go. And she's making a note.
You stupid thing. Okay. So I told you that's what I was about to do. I did it anyway. Even after you told me. God! Worst night ever, and I'm just kidding. So, she's going to communicate with Kit Fisto, let him know that they have some type of parasite on board. It's not safe for them to dock. Like, and he's like, no, 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 the only way we can get rid of this parasite is to examine it.
Mm-hmm.
Which, she's like, well, I don't really think that's a good idea, but I'm going to follow your order. Like, here she is being loyal.
As a matter of fact. Good. She had a bad feeling about this.
Right, she did. Then she also is able to communicate with Anakin as well and tells him what's going on. And
this is where Papa Anakin comes out.
It is, because, you know, as they were leaving Geonosis, they had taken...
Poggle the Lesser,
yes.
Who was their head... of everything.
Yes, yeah. They took him with him. And so it was Ahsoka's job to go get supplies. Ahsoka and Barriss, their job was to go get supplies, while Anakin, Obi-Wan, and a couple other head honchos, I think.
They were going to take Poggle to Coruscant for interrogation.
Yes, essentially. Mm-hmm. So
Anakin moved up the time clock.
He did. So as he realized what's happening, he doesn't even, like, step aside to run in there and tell anyone else what's going on. He goes straight towards Poggle.
Yes.
And as he's walking up, cue Vader music. Dun, 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 dun.
I love how every time that comes up in Clone Wars 2, as soon as that theme plays, both of us look at each other like, stuff's about to go down.
I just like shrink down into some like evil little being, and my fingers just start like kind of
good.
I turn into Palpatine essentially. Let you search your feelings. Because, I mean, as much as I don't like Anakin becoming Vader, I love it when he hits those, like, dark moments and dark sides.
Mm-hmm.
Like, if Anakin could just stay Anakin and just was able to access these, like,
just be scary Anakin, moments. Yeah,
yeah, like, it's been so good to me. Because I know it's bad when you think about the way the Jedi are supposed to act and operate. Like, this is never what was supposed to happen.
Mm-hmm.
But I like it so much. And I really wish that we were able to see more of Anakin accessing this scary side with the music. But then I guess if the music wouldn't have meant anything, if he wouldn't have ever became Vader. But it's okay. Yeah. So he goes, and as he's walking up to, like, the cell door, he's like, leave us.
Yeah, the clones just leave.
They just walk
away. It's never a good idea if somebody goes, you know what? I don't want any witnesses.
Right.
How about you take off?
Well, it's funny because there's a droid in the room with him, but that's because nobody can understand him because he speaks Geonosian.
Mm-hmm.
So the droid is the one who translates, and he, like, puts his hand up. He's like, you'll tell me what I want to know.
Yeah.
And this Geonosian is kind of like, giggle, giggle, giggle. Your mind tricks don't work on me, Jedi. And so the droid talks back to him. He says, your mind tricks don't work on him or something. I don't know. Yeah. It's funny. I like it. And he's like, he seems so, it's funny because he acts like he's defeated for just a second.
Mm-hmm.
And Anakin's like, oh, mind tricks won't work. I don't need them. And next thing you know, he's like holding.
Force choking him up against the wall.
Yes. He's got him up by like the throat. Well, we don't see you technically. He's force choking. Force choking, hence the force.
Yeah.
But yeah, against the wall, just choking him out. Mm-hmm. And we don't know what else happened.
What I love, though, is that even though the protocol droid, It was the standard protocol droid face. It felt like he was a little terrified.
No, I was totally going to say that too.
Like, I saw his face, and even though his expression cannot change, I was like, that boy's messed up.
Right.
He's a little scared.
That droid, like, it really wanted to leave the room.
Yeah.
But
it was like the longer the conversation went on, he was like, I'm uncomfortable. Can I be excused?
Right, but its job was to
translate.
Yep. So it
the life of a protocol droid.
I know. They'll wipe its mind.
It'll
be fine.
I know, right?
It won't remember a thing.
What makes it even more scary? Because, like, what else has it seen?
Oh, I don't know.
It's a dark road.
I mean, if he's with the Jedi and the clones, probably not too much. Not unless he's stationed with Anakin a lot.
Well,
which makes you wonder where C-3PO was.
That's true.
So, because he does end up in Clone Wars a lot with them, but that wasn't C-3PO.
Yeah.
So I wonder what he was doing. R2 wasn't there either.
Nope.
Where were they? We'll find out later. The Chronicles of C-3PO and R2-D2.
But as Anakin leaves the cell, what's really funny is, like, he gets out and he's like, so the worms are susceptible to cold, and like basically gives everything that they need to know. And they're like, oh, wow, how did you find that out? Well, I talked to Poggle. You interrogated Poggle? How did you get him to talk?
Look.
Yeah. Well, look.
All that matters is that we have the information we need. And they just kind of drop it because I think they all realized that they didn't want to, didn't want to know the answer.
Exactly. It was a question that they asked that they really didn't want to know the answer.
Right.
I could just see Anakin be like, hey, so just so you know, the next time you go see Poggle, probably going to be a little bruised. Black eye or two, you know?
Yeah.
Some broken limbs.
Broken limbs, maybe missing a few toes.
Nothing to worry about.
But he's totally fine.
We had a tussle.
Right. But he's totally fine. He assured me he was not pressing charges. No,
right. But yeah, no, I love that. And I agree with you. The Anakin moments, like, even though they're scary and obviously meant to show his dark side surfacing, it's Papa Anakin.
It is. And see, the thing
is, It wasn't a selfish thing. It was, you're messing with my Padawan.
Right, exactly. And that's what we even said. You know, it seems really scary, almost like he's losing control, but at the same time,
he was in control.
Oh, he was. That's the thing.
That was the scariest part.
Exactly. He is. He is fully in control. And it's like, and he wouldn't just go off the edge like this for anyone.
Mm-mm.
He, you know, we saw that side come out of him when it came to his mom. Anytime Obi-Wan's involved, we see that side come out of him. With Ahsoka involved, with Padme involved.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there's no, you don't mess with the people he loves. When you mess with those people, like, you're going to get Vaderkin.
Vaderkin. I ship it.
Vanakin? Is Vanakin better?
Vanakin. I like Vaderkin.
Okay. I was just checking. I was trying out a few things there. Anteater. Jeez. Okay. But he definitely really only lets his scary side show when there's somebody he loves involved. Mm-hmm. And he knew that Ahsoka was in trouble. Mm-hmm. So he had to act quick. He had to act fast. He didn't have time to ask permission. It was do now, ask for forgiveness later. And yep. Honestly, in my opinion, Anakin's never looking for forgiveness, though. So no.
He's just kind of like, well, take whatever consequence. I mean, last week we talked about Yoda was like, oh, your specialty in disobeying the Jedi Council you have.
Right. Right, which is very funny. Yep. So after he finds out the answer on what to do, we realize that he's like, Ahsoka, you have to go, I don't think he says destroy, but...
Rupture.
Rupture.
Yeah, the, rupture the coolant system.
Yes, the coolant system, because mm-hmm. essentially these parasites do not survive the cold, mm-hmm. which is kind of funny because most parasites don't,
I'm not.
I could be wrong about that, but I don't think a lot of parasites live in the cold. I think that's why we don't see a bunch of bugs in the winter.
Maybe. I don't know.
I don't either. I feel like I should Google this real quick, but then we don't sound like an idiot, but... But I'm just going to go with it. Okay.
But in the scene, though, when he's telling her all the things to do and stuff like that, Barriss sneaks up on her. And this is before Ahsoka knows that Barriss has been compromised.
That's a creepy freaking moment.
So
and
you know what I realized, creepy. Too?
At first, I thought it was a door. At first, I thought it was a door right there. I thought she had some, like, shield door up.
Yeah.
In kind of order to protect herself because she was a little vulnerable by just sitting there, you know, talking. No, that was just like a...
It was like a map kind
of
thing.
Yeah, it was just like a thing in the middle of the room that was like a map or something on it.
And then here, Barriss is standing over like Michael Myers, ready to pounce.
Michael Myers? I thought this was Paranormal Activity. It's like the ghost sitting on your bed as you're sleeping, and it drags you up by the leg down the hallway down the stairs.
And it has a worm in its mouth.
Yeah. So, and at this point, like, she looks over and sees her, and she's like, oh, Barriss, it's just you. And as soon as, like, she really looks at Barriss good, and Barriss just doesn't say anything. She's just standing there cold. And
you're right, I agree. End of Paranormal Activity for sure.
Yeah. It's straight up.
It's messed up.
Straight up spooky.
Yeah.
And she realizes that that's no longer Barriss. Mm-hmm. Like, Barriss has been compromised. And so... Barriss, which is creepy. Like I said, we talked about these invaders taking over the clones, and they did the same thing with Barriss.
Mm-hmm.
Barriss is a Jedi. Barriss is force sensitive. Barriss knows how to use a lightsaber.
Mm-hmm.
So that's exactly what they do, is she uses the force and blows the glass out of that little mappy thingy. And her and Ahsoka have a tuffle.
Yes, they do. They absolutely do. Very scary one, because the worm keeps deciding that it wants to go,
hello. Right. It's only me.
Yeah.
Don't you remember me?
Yeah. And then, like, everyone, like, I think Barriss, I don't know what it is she says, but she says something, but it's like almost like Mother Talzin style, like all crazy, like, or something. I don't know.
I know what you're talking about, but I don't remember.
I don't remember what she says, but it's terrifying.
Yeah. But it's creepy, though, is as the cold's kind of setting into Barriss, like you said, that worm kind of keeps poking in and out, like like it's trying, like there's a struggle, because that worm's trying to stay in her.
It struggles worse with her than it does the clones, it seems.
It does, and I wonder why.
I don't know.
But, I mean, they don't give
really
us much.
It really fights her, though.
It does.
Yeah.
And at one point, she even looks at Ahsoka, and she's like, kill me.
Yeah.
Which is creepy, because it makes me wonder, like, who was that?
But
at the same time, the worm wouldn't benefit from saying that.
It would have died at that. I wonder if she had killed Barriss at that point, the worm would have only taken over Ahsoka at that point. Because it could have been the worm looking for survival.
I don't know.
That is creepy, though.
I mean, it kept trying to take over.
Especially with the feud and the fight and everything between... Ahsoka and Barriss, and then the worm coming out of the mouth and all all this is so gross to talk about. just the imagery in my head, I'm like, oh god, this sucks. it's almost like it's like warring Barriss's. It's like, is it like you said, is it the worm or is it Barriss? And so I wonder if during that whole point, Barriss was coming in and out of consciousness. Like the worm was slowly letting go, but then it would grab back or something like that.
Which I mean, no, really I think it definitely was that because, like I said, that worm was definitely coming out. I don't think that worm was coming out because it was really it was trying to get Ahsoka, but I think it was also fighting for its life. Mm-hmm. Like it wanted to take over another being mm-hmm. because it was being forced out of one. And that mm-hmm. was the only way to survive. It was either coming out and dying or going into something else. Mm-hmm. So, and I do think that, but that's what that line when she says about killing her, like that was so like. That was so creepy, but at the same time, when you look back to that point though, when they decide to split up, Barriss makes that comment to Ahsoka, and like you will do the right thing, like you will do the mm-hmm. the thing that will essentially
help us succeed. You'll make the tough decision,
right?
Yeah,
and
which I wonder why she automatically assumes that Ahsoka could do something like that. But I wonder if it's just Barriss discounting herself out of it, knowing that she couldn't make that decision. Or if there's some other factor that makes her think that Ahsoka is superior to her.
I don't know. Like, I wonder the time difference between them. Like, I know they're probably about the same age, mm-hmm. but I wonder how long Ahsoka's been in the Jedi Order compared to Barriss.
Also, that makes me wonder, too, and this is not this episode, but it makes me wonder on down the line when Barriss frames her, if she just thought that Ahsoka could handle it more. Or that Ahsoka would be able to deal with it better than any other Padawan. I don't know.
You know what? When you said that, I thought this was going to be something for another podcast, but let me just get this out really quick. So The reason I think now that we're kind of talking about it and reviewing this episode together and all this stuff that's kind of come in play, mm-hmm. I feel like she does it because everyone might view Ahsoka as, you know, obviously she's Anakin's Padawan. And if people know about Anakin, they can only imagine Ahsoka's the same way. And that she'll do whatever it takes. Mm. So they already thought that she had something against crap, who was it? Because she killed somebody. Somebody died. Oh, it was that prisoner. That prisoner yes. who blew up the something at the temple. Mm-hmm. And they already knew that she was angry at that person. So I think she framed Ahsoka because it wouldn't have been unordinary for Ahsoka to necessarily do something like that.
Do something extreme. And
yes.
Not... Makes sense.
So, because I don't know, I'm so... Now I feel like we need to go back and watch, like, everything. Everything with, like, Barriss and Ahsoka in it. And we have, like, a Barriss-Ahsoka episode.
I'm down.
So now I'm just like, my little brain's just a twirling over here. Like, so many things.
The conspiracy theories are flowing.
Yes. So this kind of brings us to the end of our episode. And as everything, well, not really in, but so essentially what happens is Barriss is able to fight off the little thingy. It comes out of her mouth, dies. Or no, Ahsoka cuts it.
Ahsoka
cuts it, but you don't know
that.
The
last scene that we see is Ahsoka striking. With a lightsaber, but we don't know if it's Barriss. We don't know if it's the worm. We don't know what it is. And it's like, oh god, did Ahsoka go there?
Right. I think it pans to them trying to stop the ship at the medical station, and then in comes Kit Fisto and a couple clones, and they find Ahsoka on the ground holding Barriss, and they're both like,
and the
shivering.
Worm's in half.
It is, yeah. So we realize she doesn't kill Barriss, which is awesome. Or is it? Just kidding. But
traitor.
Pretty much. Still salty, if you can't tell.
You can't sit with us.
Exactly. So she does make that decision to not kill her and just kills the worm. It pans away a little bit and we see Ahsoka laying like in a hospital bed essentially. Yeah. And Anakin's at the end of her bed sitting in a chair waiting for her to wake up. And she like wakes up like in panic. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, she was kind of almost frozen to death a little bit ago. So, I mean.
and sleep at that point would have meant that she would have been taken over by a worm.
Right. And the first thing, like, she really asks is, like, is Barriss okay? Mm-hmm. And next to her lies Barriss, who's still sleeping soundly over there. And this is the coolest part to me in the episode, really, was the ending.
Master. On the ship, Barriss was gone, and she wanted me to kill her. She told me...
But you couldn't do it.
No. No, I couldn't. But should I have? I mean, it worked out now. But if we had failed, if the ship docked and the worm spread and...
Ahsoka, it's your duty to save as many lives as you can. Barriss knew you could save thousands if the worms were destroyed, which she thought meant destroying her too. But you did the right thing. You knew the freezing cold would kill the worms. Letting go of our attachments is a difficult struggle for all of us. You followed your instincts. I'm sure she would agree that you made the right choice.
Essentially, I think she questions her strength as a Jedi, really, because essentially, Jedi are looked at to be able to do what it takes.
Right.
No matter the, not necessarily no matter the consequences, but that's kind of why their attachment's forbidden.
Right.
Is because, like,
you saying, have to do the tough things. You have to make the hard choices. Yeah.
Right. Because if it would have been like a Anakin Ahsoka situation and one of them were taken over by something, like, they would be expected to end the other's life if need be.
Right.
No matter the relationship. Mm-hmm. And so that's just kind of what her struggle was. And Anakin lets her know that, no, like, you essentially followed your instinct and you did the right thing. Mm-hmm. And I think that kind of loops us back to our fortune cookie, because it says attachment is not compassion.
Mm-hmm. So attachment is not compassion. What do you think that means?
So I'm going to try to word this the best way I can.
Okay.
But until we went back and saw what the fortune cookie was for this one, that's when it really hit me, was the ending. Mm-hmm. Because to me, what it's saying is, like, just because you have attachment to something, like, I feel like this is going to come out and it's going to contradict itself.
Yeah.
I don't know. It's like, not necessarily you have to have compassion for it. Because so essentially, like, I don't know. It's just, to me, it speaks to that dilemma that she had, whether she did the right thing or not. Mm-hmm. Whether or not it, you know, she should have killed Barriss. Or if she should have let her live. And even though she did the right thing, like...
Well, to me, it feels like... So in that situation with her moral dilemma at the very end, attachment is not compassion. To me, it sounds like it's not the same as compassion. So attachment being, she's my friend, that's why I spared her. Kind of thing like that.
Right.
Versus having compassion on a thing in trouble. A person in trouble and everything. And I think that she did the compassion thing, because if she would have gone strictly on attachment, the answer would have been to do what Barriss said and kill her.
Yes.
But
that's kind of what I was thinking too. I'm going to word this the best way I can. And when it was about to come out, I was like, God, this is going to contradict itself. And I don't want it to sound contradicting.
Well, you helped me formulate mine, because until you started talking, I didn't really know what it meant, to be honest.
Right.
But
that's exactly what I'm thinking too. It's like, essentially, you can have attachment to something, but it doesn't mean you have to have compassion for it.
Because attachment to me is more objective than anything, where compassion is more a love, a caring. And everything. And so I don't feel like it was attachment that got in the way or anything like that. She had compassion on her suffering companion.
Right.
And her suffering companion as a being, I think that's what it was.
Yeah.
And so it's basically, even though it says attachment is not compassion, attachment is not the same as compassion, I think is what it means.
Yeah. I mean... That's kind of the point of being like a quick little fortune cookie,
I know.
And I don't know, to me, like, and you know, I love the fortune cookies at the beginning of Clone Wars, and I kind of wish they were like in everything, because they're awesome. I don't know, maybe it's just the first time I've noticed how well the fortune cookie fit.
Well, we never go back and look at them. Like, it's like at the very first, and then we don't think about it again.
Until the next one. They're like, oh, that's a cool fortune cookie. So it makes me want to start over and, like, take a picture of that fortune cookie and then just keep that in mind throughout the entire episode and find out where it fits. Because I feel like they did, well, I mean, obviously they did it on purpose. They wouldn't just stick fortune cookies in there. Because I don't feel like they would. Obviously,
no, it's all purposeful,
Right. I just haven't found that purpose for them all yet. Until we watched this one and we went back and we were like, oh, what's that fortune cookie? And I was like, oh, snap. Just like I said, with that moral dilemma she had, it just, to me, that... Like, you could almost just read that fortune cookie and watch the very end dilemma, and it would just all make sense to you, really and truly.
Definitely.
Because it's like, ah! But yeah.
Yeah.
So that's what my intake was on that fortune cookie.
Yeah, I agree with you.
Cool. Yeah. I'm glad I was able to give you my insights. I know you always have a way of finishing what I'm thinking. And I love that, obviously. Because, like I said, I felt like I was going to contradict myself. Because I was about to be like, well, attachment, it's not the same as compassion. And just because you have attachment doesn't mean it has to be compassion. But yeah. I was like, this sounds like it's contradicting. So. But we were able to word it out.
That's why we're a good team.
Yeah. Woo! High five.
I think it's interesting that it took the Brain Invaders episode to get your fortune cookie realization.
I'm sure there's been times where I probably have put the fortune cookies together with the episode in some form or fashion, but I don't feel like it's ever clicked this well. Because this one, I was actually, when we went back to the fortune cookie, I was like, yeah. Like, it literally clicked with that last scene. I was like, oh my god, this all makes so much sense now.
Yeah.
So
overall, last impressions, this definitely had a horror movie feel to it.
Oh, it did.
A lot of elements to it were really creepy.
Yeah.
Just worms and noses, guys. Worms and noses.
Worms and mouths. What are you talking about? Worms
moist
and mouths.
Slithering. Right. Let me say that again. Moist slithering.
And once again,
that's enough to give you nightmares.
Right. And once again, if you don't like watching movies with subtitles, then, I mean, too bad. Like, just do it. Watch Star Wars with subtitles on, because there's been so much.
It's enlightening.
It is. There's been so much we've noticed over the course of our rewatches and even moving into our Halloween special. Subtitles just really makes a difference to us.
Absolutely, yeah.
So, just give it a try, because, I mean, I know I used to be really weird about subtitles, and I used to not like them, but when it comes to Star Wars, I like them.
Oh, absolutely. So, you miss a lot if you don't.
Right. I mean, there's small things.
Or at least
things.
We do.
Yeah, we do. You know, we've talked about those in previous episodes, too. There's things we hear or see in the subtitles that we didn't hear in the movie.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Absolutely.
Do it.
Kristen advocates for subtitles.
I do. Do it. This is not paid advertisement, just so you know.
Who would even pay you?
No. I don't know. The subtitle company? Like, somebody's got to sit and subtitle everything. That actually would be pretty fun to do.
Oh my goodness.
I wonder who heard Ray.
Ray?
Ray? Sorry. Okay. But yes, so finishing up our Monster Madness episode 2, yes. Brain Invaders.
Absolutely. I never imagined that we would find story points and theories and stuff like that in a Worms and Brains episode.
Right.
Basically the Body Snatchers episode. So
basically.
Yeah, but it's been really cool. It's really fun. Next week, guys, so we're continuing our
monster.
Super spooky Monster Madness.
Madness. Yes. I was trying to like get in there with you on it, and it just you added more words that I thought were there.
So we are going to be talking, actually visiting the, world of Star Wars Rebels. We haven't gone back to Rebels since the end, I don't think. But we are going back to Star Wars Rebels with Always Two There Are.
Yes.
So the first introduction of the incredibly terrifying seventh sister and fifth brother. So very exciting, very cool, very, Michael Myers like. It'll be really fun, so definitely check that out. And also, if you haven't already, check out our Resistance review. Episode 1 is already up for The Recruit. We had a lot of fun recording it. It was a lot of fun watching it.
Yes, it was.
We really enjoyed Resistance, way more than we thought we would. So definitely check that out. And episode 2 will be up this coming Monday as well. Mm-hmm. So check that out as well. And Kristen, did you have anything else?
Nope, I don't. Just thanks to the fans who always continue to listen and support us.
Absolutely. You guys are amazing. We really appreciate your support. It's what keeps us going and what keeps us doing this crazy little podcast thing. So we really appreciate you guys. And if you are not already, you can follow us on social media at Kesselrun Weekly on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. You can find us on our website, kesselrunweekly.com. And if you enjoyed this episode or any prior or future episodes, you can leave a review on iTunes. Leave us a 5-star review. We will read it on the show because now we know how to find them.
Yes. Maybe just send us a quick DM or something. Let us know that you put one up.
Hey, heads up.
just because, like, some reason we don't get notified when they pop up. So we actually just had Kira tell us that she put one on there, and that's how we realized we had recent ones. So, so our bad. So just maybe just shoot us a quick little thing and just be like, maybe like check iTunes or did a quick review for you guys or just something like this, just so we know. We'll try to be better keeping up with it though. But in case,
any 5-star reviews we will absolutely read on the show, and we appreciate your feedback. And if you have any ideas for future episodes or anything like that, or anything you want to hear on the podcast, let us know. We'll be happy to take it into consideration and, you know, probably do it.
We're up for ideas.
Yeah, we're absolutely up for ideas. So cool, guys. So thank you again for listening, watching another episode of Kessel Run Weekly. My name is Danny.
And I'm Kristen.
And may the Force be with you.
Always.